Hi, I'm Vince, also known as PleasantKenobi on the internet, and here's a video about card games. So fun fact, I had a video planned. I've started writing out a small amount of the script called Three Things I Hate About Arena. Yes, the title is inflammatory and provocative, I get it. One of those three things was its lack of support for eternal formats or non-rotating formats. I've been going back and forth on some of the points and I keep adding to the scripts. It's currently shelved. I made the video eventually because I'll be honest, I still think the arena economy is fucking shit, but it might end up just being a video about the arena economy instead. But here's the thing, right? I want to give credit where credit is due. I often rag on Wizards of the Coast for very bad decisions and making mistakes and fuck-ups and, well, there's a lot of that because they make a lot of mistakes and fuck-ups, but let's be honest, Amonkhet Remastered is really fucking cool. They have brought a refreshing take to a set that I don't think is much beloved. I don't know how many people were like raging to play Amonkhet again, but they've updated the draft environment and brought cards that were needed for Historic into that set as well, and released it onto Arena, and also the board that you can play on with the snow coming over the city. The snow? The sand coming over the city? Mwah, it's beautiful. So yeah, I'm impressed. Adding that, the three anthologies and Jumpstart, and Historic starting to shape up to be quite a cool and interesting format. It is, in essence, Arena's very own eternal format. And for that reason, that's why this video's here, it may well be the future of eternal and digital magic. But let me explain what I mean by the word eternal first, because there's going to be some keyboard warriors down below. Well, actually-ing. Let's talk about that for a second. The literal meaning is formats where all non-silver bordered cards are legal, barring the banned lists of those formats. This means that only Vintage, Legacy, Commander, and Pauper are truly eternal. But honestly, I keep seeing people talking about and using the word eternal to mean non-rotating. They're using it interchangeably with the word non-rotating. I find myself doing it as well. And there will be Magic players who prefer to be, I guess, technically correct, or figuratively, no, not figuratively, not technically, literally correct to the letter, than actually add any nuance or discussion or interesting point to the discussion. So they will go, well, no, actually, modern's not eternal. And I'm like, who gives a fuck? Like, what value is added by differentiating the two? I genuinely believe that differentiating between eternal and non-rotating is kind of pedantry at this point and serves no real purpose. So for that reason, I'm going to use the two relatively interchangeably, and I'm going to put eternal in quotation marks to let you know that, essentially. Honestly, the only real difference between the two is that the true eternal formats are hounded with the piss-poor mistakes that Wizards of the Coast made many moons ago in creating the reserve list, and effectively sending them to a slow entropy that is inevitable on a long enough timeline. So thanks for that, Wizards. So when I sit here and say that is Historic the future of MTG, of Magic the Gathering, and I contemplatively pause like this, and then I turn to the camera and I say, yes, what I mean is the future of digital and eternal magic. Now, that's not to say that Standard is going anywhere, right? Wizards of the Coast make most of their money out of Standard, supposedly. It is their mainline format that rotates, so it causes people to begin by cracking boosters or putting money into the MTG Arena economy with very little to show for it and no ability to dust anything. And then when rotation comes, it restarts that cycle and on we go around the fucking, I say rabbit wheel, a hamster wheel, chasing that carrot, spending money. And to be fair, sure, that makes sense. The company needs to make money, right? At risk of sounding incredibly cynical, I guess you could say that Standard is Wizards of the Coast functioning at peak capitalism. Instead of giving you a car that runs forever, they instead cut a hole in your pocket and siphon out your money for the privilege of playing Magic. That said, that sounds like a value judgment coming from someone who is primarily into eternal formats, and I guess it is because I jokingly mock Standard, but I get there are positives and upsides to Standard too. The biggest one being is that the rotation causes Standard to get varied and shook up and changed, so you're not playing the same thing all the time, and it brings variety and a challenge for you to try and crack the Standard metagame in its small period of flux that you get. So I get why grinders are super into it, that and it's the main competitive format, but also I get why people like that sort of puzzle that they've got to solve it in a short enough time frame before it moves on, and it's also more accessible. The accessibility comes in the form of knowledge. Instead of jumping into Historic or Pioneer or Modern or Legacy or Vintage or even Commander, where there's all these cards you don't understand, these archetypes you don't understand, Standard is a finite pool of cards, so it makes it easier to kind of just get into. Although I don't generally recommend it to new players because I feel like it is a waste of money if you're playing on a budget. But beyond Standard, one of the greatest things Magic the Gathering's got going for it is that each of the game pieces you have, each of the cards that you have, are interchangeably playable in many, many different ways. Right from kitchen table top, no-rules casual Magic, right through to honed 75-card legacy decks, and everything in between, Magic is incredibly varied. One of the reasons I think I became so entrenched myself and started making content is that you can make all sorts of content, and you can play all sorts of Magic across all the formats. The variety is there. It's hard to get truly burnt out or bored of Magic because there are so many formats to play. That said, sometimes wizards make a mistake, like Companions, that goes ahead and homogenizes every single format, and they really fuck the game up. But today's video is not about design mistakes, and we are past Companion now. I guess I'll just never truly get over how much of a grotesque mistake it was. So, in short, on a personal level, I feel like the game of Magic the Gathering requires things like Historic, and Modern, and Legacy, and Commander to give us places to play with all our old favourite cards, and also give us respite from playing, well, Standard over and over again, although I don't do that much anymore. It's important to me that these things exist. Variety is the spice of life. Variety is the sugar that allows the medicine to go down. And the medicine is existence. And existence is pain. And historically, Wizards of the Coast have also wanted these formats to exist, not just a player desire, because it gives life to your rotatoes. A rotato being a card that is rotating, soon to become a potato. A thing that's useless. Although, actually, the term doesn't make a whole lot of sense, because potatoes are quite useful. You can, like, cook them and fry them and shit. You can throw them at your enemies. You can stick them up your ass. Back in the day, formats were called types. Or I guess back in the day, formats didn't exist. But when the types came around, which according to the MTG Wiki was in 1995, at the same time they introduced or began to name what's now known as Vintage as Type 1, we got Standard as Type 2. And there's some perhaps irony in the fact that Standard ended up being Type 2, suggesting just by the very nature of how numbering worked that Type 1 was more important. But then Standard became the de facto go-to important thing. A little bit later, we got Type 1.5, which was like a middle ground between Type 1 and Extended, which was a thing that was introduced later, which was like a longer rotating version of Standard. It was called Type 1.5, Legacy was, and then it became Legacy in 2004. The problem was, between 1995 and 2004, there was the reserve list created. They promised that they wouldn't reprint certain cards ever again to allow collectors to not feel like they're going to have their investment destroyed from out under them. Their investment in a supposedly children's card game, or at the very least, a nerdy hobby. Yeah, Magic's fucking weird. 2011 rolls around and we get Modern. Modern is introduced quite literally as a way of giving us a non-rotating format, an eternal format, that doesn't have the problem of the reserve list. I quote, "A long time ago we promised not to reprint a certain list of cards. Some of those cards have become important parts of tournament legacy. Although we regret that promise now, it is a promise that we made and we intend to keep it. Much of the appeal of Legacy is that the format does not rotate. However, as Legacy becomes more and more popular, the relative supply of these cards, as compared to the size of the audience that wants to play with them, is only going down. This makes the format less and less accessible to new entrants over time." Like I said, on a long enough timeline, the entropy that is applied to older formats, the true eternal formats because of the reserve lifts, will fucking kill them. Because there just won't be enough underground seas left in the world as they still get damaged or sucked up by MTG finance nerds. Anyway, that point aside, there's another beautiful irony here, and by beautiful I mean fucking tragic, so why I say beautiful I don't know. The tragedy being that Modern has now had the same problem happen to it that befell Legacy. Modern doesn't have its actual reserve list. There are no cards that have been promised that they can't ever be reprinted, but there are cards that Wizards of the Coast seem reluctant to reprint. I guess that's a fair way of putting it. My theory, or my conjecture, or my tinfoil hat moment, or conversation that I often have, is that I believe that Wizards of the Coast are very much aware of the secondary market, even though they won't admit it publicly because of the problems that would bring with gambling. And I believe because of this knowledge of it, there are people at the company who keep an eye on prices and don't want to crash them on cards that, I don't know, collectors have lots of, or stores and vendors have lots of. This means that through the very nature of how desirable lands have become, that fetch lands have become part of this, I'm just going to call it the second reserve list. They're not unprintable. We saw some get printed recently in the Secret Lair thing, but they're not willing to crash the price on them. They're essentially a gold standard. These are cards that will always be worth something because Wizards of the Coast will never crash them with truly meaningful reprints. And I've gone about this a lot on the channel. I launched a t-shirt range. I did fucking videos on this, and I'm kind of tired of it at this point. I still think it's dumb. Essentially, I guess this is a tangent here. I need to explain my stance on this a little bit. I completely appreciate that crashing the entire like secondary market and the MTG economy, whilst idealistic in terms of getting it accessible to everyone, it's a very socialist thing, and I'm quite a bit of a socialist, I guess. I'm a bit of a lefty. But I also understand that that would have knock-on effects that are not desirable either and would probably be quite irresponsible. There is an entire economy, an entire industry based around this game of buying and selling cards. And this doesn't mean those guys with a huge fucking suitcase on the GP floors, you know, wheeling and dealing. I mean stores, my sponsor, all the stores. So from Channel Fireball through to TCG Player and so on and so on. These stores, the game stores too. Think of your favourite game store, which is making its money being a brick and mortar store selling sealed product, but it makes more money selling singles, right? That's an entire fucking industry that we can't destroy overnight because people's livelihoods are on the line. And by that I mean people just running businesses, your average business owner. I know some people probably sit in the comment section saying, fuck them, who cares? But that's not fair in my eyes. However, I do think that cards that essentially form the chessboard upon which we play this strategic card game, the fucking mana bases that we build and use to control and pilot our decks, they're not the cards where the prices should be high. They're the cards that should be accessible and we can have collectible versions of other things, or even just the actual, even the deck staples. Let's say like Goyfs and Liliana's were expensive. At least when you've got your mana base, you can play other off-kilter stuff and rogue decks, but the mana base is just being piss poor. Doesn't help anyone. So I've banged that drum enough. So back to my point, Modern now suffers the same fate as Legacy, where the format is not accessible, it's expensive. So what do Wizards of the Coast do? Well, they launch Pioneer. Pioneer being the same thing again. Its relationship to Modern is the same way that Modern was to Legacy. It's designed with the fetch lands all banned upon entry to be a more accessible non-rotating format for newer players. And honestly, as long as Paper Magic exists, I see a need for this to happen every 5, 6, 7, or 8 years or whatever to allow people to get into the game, because the older cards are going to get more and more expensive as long as the reprint policies of Wizards of the Coast continue to be quite shit. The funny thing about all of that is that Legacy, they can't reprint because of this supposed legal promise they made. Modern cards, they can reprint, but they choose not to. So then they make Pioneer to fix that. And you can kind of see where I'm coming from with this issue, right? It's funny because Pioneer and Historic are contemporaries in a lot of ways. They're temporally close in terms of like coming out, was it last year, I believe, both of them? But they exist in their own spaces. Pioneer being a physical card game, and on Modo, of course, as well. And Historic being a format that is exclusively currently on Arena, although I can see it bleeding through to paper if it becomes popular enough. They're also distinctive, just so you know, this is a full comprehensive education, that Pioneer starts from RTR onwards, where Historic has this interesting thing of going backwards. Instead of just picking an arbitrary point or a desired point and moving forward and allowing it all to be accessible, a lot of these cards just aren't available on Arena yet, so we're going back. We're going backwards, adding sets. In this case, Amonkhet Remastered just came out. But we're also adding cards and sets through Jumpstart, Historic sets being released, and of course Historic Anthologies, which is a collection of like 10 cards you can buy from the shop that are now legal in the format. And it's interesting to see them like embrace some sort of historic format like this, some Eternal format on Arena, because they have been, in recent times, really hostile towards Eternal formats. Don't forget, they originally wanted to have every wild card for Historic cost 2 wild cards, every card you want to make. So if you want a 4 Juggernaut, what's a card in Historic, Gitrog Monster, you had to use 2 wild cards. And everyone went fucking berserk, myself included, saying this is shit, no one's going to play your fucking format, and they backtracked on that. So don't forget, they are looking for ways to monetize this beyond, in case it becomes more popular than standard. And don't forget as well, like I said, they have been hostile towards Eternal formats. Last year, they changed the Legacy GP in America, so they probably won't be a Legacy GP in America. It'll be another format because, and I'm paraphrasing the Reddit post here, but Legacy doesn't do the numbers. Which is bizarre because that's like a hand-wavy corporate-like answer, which to the average person like ourselves, what that really is a fucking lie. Whilst if every GP was Legacy, they wouldn't do so well, having one a year that all the Legacy players go to has been very successful. GP Prague last year got like 3,000 people, roughly speaking. I'd have to look at the exact numbers in the main event, plus people for sides, buying cards, getting involved in this economy and industry that we have, buying things from artists. And then at the time, how were standard GPs doing? They're struggling to get 300 players. My point is, you don't need a million of these things, but one would help, because there's people out there that want to spend the money on the event. And that goes on to another point where Wizards have these weird, basically lies that they come out with, or at least misinformation or misjudgments about the Eternal formats. And some of the player base lap them up and repeat them back to you when you talk about these formats. One of the common ones is, how does Wizards of the Coast monetize Eternal Magic? Whether that be Modern or Legacy or to this extent now Pioneer. They say that you can't monetize them, you can't sell cards to those players. And that's really weird, because we have this, and this, and this. Then we have this, 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 and this. And we've got Pioneer Masters on the horizon as well. Now, sure, some of the hype and the drive for those things, the desirability comes from Commander. Commander Staples is a way that sells those packs. But some of those things like Goyfs and Lilianas and shit, people aren't getting those for Commander. The desirability comes from Modern or Legacy. And whilst people claim Legacy players won't crack packs, that's also a weird, like, fucking untruth. Have you met some Legacy players? They are filthy, filthy whales that Wizards of the Coast would love to milk if they realised they fucking existed. My point is that there's an ecosystem as part of this industry that we're talking about, the secondary market, MTG Finance, hashtag listen to my advice on Twitter and all that shit, right? All of this is based around a ecosystem. And if some of those cards are desirable and Wizards of the Coast can sell the packs at £10, as long as the packs are desirable because the desirable cards in them, they can sell the packs at £10 and make their money, right? Or whatever the fuck the cost of a Master set is now, people will buy them. And those cards will be sold on the secondary market to Eternal players. Do you see what I mean? Even if they aren't buying them directly, which they fucking are, they're still fueling the purchase of this stuff. And round the wheel goes, and magic carries on as it always has. I'm not even saying, by the way, I'm not even saying this is a fucking conspiracy theory. I'm not even saying that Wizards of the Coast are lying for some sort of nefarious ends. To me, this might even just be genuine incompetency of people not realizing like how this is all working. I'm not even saying I'm a business fucking genius either. I just think it's very fucking clear when you lay it all out. Part of me wonders if this is some Hasbro exec who doesn't understand the fact that there are people out there who spend a shit ton of money on this fucking game, even on the secondary market, on these old boarded cards that people don't understand why they're worth money. And that money feeds into keeping these vendors and stores and shit alive. What the fuck is the point of having cards worth money if the places you play those cards die off and dwindle, right? Because then those cards won't be worth shit unless, I guess, people just keep them as collector's items. Would a Tarn be a collector's item in spite of all the formats you can play them in dying off? You know what? Probably. The world's fucking weird. Magic's weird. So, I don't think Modern or Legacy are dead, by the way. Just because I think Historic is kind of the future of ongoing Eternal Magic. Those ones won't die. People like myself will continue to play them. People watching this video, if you sit at home and you're planning to play them once the COVID's out of the way, you know, that's another big problem for these formats, right? Then they're not dead. They will be on the side events of whatever happens after COVID. Fucking COVID as well, right? So, why is Historic the future? The main premise of this video, and I'm like 20 minutes in, but I was giving so much context around Eternal Magic, I'm gonna have to rename the fucking video so people don't get angry in the comment sections. There's two main reasons. The first one is really obvious, and it's gonna sound very obvious, and I'm sorry it's so obvious, but it's really fucking fun. It's refreshing. I've enjoyed playing Arena. I actually ground the ladder up to Platinum maybe one or two seasons ago, about a month or so ago, with the Affinity deck, because I was enjoying it. I was playing on stream and talking to people about how much I was enjoying it. And then I've played, like, I think 24 games, not even got out of gold yet, 24 games this week of Historic, getting ready to do some Historic videos next week, and what made me want to make this video, because genuinely, the format is fun and interesting. There's so much new stuff that's going into it because of Jumpstart and Amonkhet Remastered, and sometimes that'd piss you off if you haven't had a chance to play with the deck in paper when there's new sets coming out immediately. But with Arena, it's less of an issue because you just get to get the cards immediately and play with them, right? And also, I've missed some of this info because I've been so much of it. An Elves player cast a collected company against me. I was like, huh, big fan of that card, didn't know it was in the set, because they've added other cards to Amonkhet, like I said, Wrath of God, collected company, for example. And yeah, I had one of those poo-poo moments where I'm like, oh fuck, I don't know what's going to happen. Am I going to die? One of those good poo-poo moments, you know? You know what I mean? No? And perhaps this is a honeymoon period. Perhaps I'm just loving it because it's so refreshing and different to all the other Eternal formats that I've been hammered with Modern, Horizons and other like nonsense shit going through current Standard. And let's be real, Magic has had its teeth kicked in by power creep and look at Standard's bans. It just goes to tell a very comprehensive story of how fucked all the power creep has been. So maybe it's how fresh it feels. But let's be real as well, with all the complaints out of the way, I remember that auto-tapper on Twitter like last night. Sure, the auto-tapper can be a pain in the ass, but Arena is slick, and it is quite fun to play. And it's just smooth in ways that Modo will never ever be. So playing a cool Eternal format with variety and stuff is wicked. And they're adding cards that are like some of my favourite cards. The Gitrog Monster's in there. No, the Reliquary's in there. Ghost Quarter's in there. If they add Leon Arbiter and Tharia, oh, they're cooking up a stew. We just need Vile and Wisp. That's the thing. Maybe I don't want it to turn into the other formats, but I wouldn't mind. The second reason is simply because... My second reason that I think Historic is like the future and a good thing for Magic other than it being fun, is that it's not marred by the same problems that Legacy was, and then Modern was, and Pioneer inevitably will be. Because of it being on Arena, cards won't spike to astronomical prices and price people out. Because of it being on Arena, they aren't limited by what they can print in the next sets for fear of, you know, crashing prices. They can put fetches into a, I don't know, Time Spiral Remastered or whatever the next one will be, and get away with it. Where in paper, they would upset whoever it is at Hasbro or Wizards going, sorry, you've used too much reprint equity. They can also go in and fix these formats with emergency injections from anthologies and from new sets. They can be like, oh, these cards are dominant. Instead of banning a load of shit, we're going to release a 5-card anthologies early and give you access to, I don't know, Python Needle. I think that's already in the set format. But, you know, some answers. Thunder, more Hellkite to beat Lingering Souls, for example. The stuff that Magic Wars historically did. The next set would have answers to cards they knew were going to be good because of the Future League. They can now do that in historic anthologies, and they can release early if they really need to fix up formats if they were looking too busted after a Pro Tour or whatever. And when cards get banned, you aren't losing out on a £40 card, you're just getting a wild card back for the wild card you spent. So in many ways, it's not as heavy an investment loss when things do get banned or temporarily suspended or whatever. However, let's talk cynically about that for a moment. When cards are banned or Mythic Anthologies come out and create a new archetype or they invalidate your deck, there is a potential, a fear, a problem where your deck that you just spent all your wild cards on, which could have cost you, you know, in theory, £100 or hours and hours and hours of work to get to, is no longer tier 1 or tier 2. It might be in tier 3 obscurity. In theory, they could, using anthology and using bans, tactically shift the metagame enough to cause people to keep buying new shit, essentially making it a rotating format. Now, that's the cynicism side of things. I believe a shifting metagame is healthy and real, and I also don't believe that hobbies shouldn't have some sort of upkeep investment. The idea of buying into a hobby and then never having to spend a dime again is very, very rare among a lot of hobbies, especially tabletop stuff like this and D&D and Warhammer and such. But, yeah, there is a fearful thing that they could really shift the metagame significantly and just or power creep things, you know, basically a small proxy of what they do with Standard into Historic. And I guess we're on that topic of like how they can manage this differently to normal sets, because they couldn't just emergency inject 8 cards into a normal set or a normal format because of how the limitations of physical paper works, but they could do that on Arena. So I guess at this point I really should address this other conversation that's coming up quite a bit. I know Nox is super keen on it, and a few of the other like Arena streamers are super, super into the idea of digital errata, of going like Runeterra or Hearthstone and erratering cards on Arena, on the fly, because you can. You have access to the ability to do that on the client. Of course, then those cards would be literally different to physical cards. And I'm not going to go into it in huge detail here. I think this could be an entire video in itself. But personally, I hate that idea. Now, beyond the initial gut reaction of, wow, that's fucking weird, it also means that cards just don't function the same between formats. And one of the great things about Magic the Gathering that I've been saying is that it has so many cool and interesting ways to play Magic. If you start having cards function differently in Historic to Standard, for example, or in Historic and Standard to Legacy and Modern, yeah, I think that's a detriment, because it will, if anything, help those older formats to die quicker, because people won't understand and there'll be more of a knowledge barrier, more complexity. I don't think people are too stupid to understand complexity, but I think adding on that sort of knowledge barrier just makes the accessibility problem even worse. In short, I think that paper magic and digital magic should be the same thing. I don't think separating the two is healthy. Especially for paper magic, because paper magic might struggle in future pandemic times, for example, or wherever the fuck we end up in this world. So that brings me to a close! That brings me to a close of my whistle-stop tour of Wizards of the Coast's relationship with Eternal Magic, and why Historic is the future of Eternal Magic. What do you think? Do you like Historic? Do you think it's shit? Do you wonder why Field of the Dead is still legal? Or any of these questions, I would like to know. Are there Historic decks that you think are particularly good or funny? Is there Historic decks that you would like to see me play on the channel or on stream or in videos? On the channel or on video? Why all? They're the same thing, Vince. Let me know in the comment section below. I've been Vince, also known as Pleasant Kenobi on the internet. I guess I'm stanning, as the kids would say, for Historic. Be good to one another. Take care. And I'll see you soon. Ta-ta for now.